afternoon, everyone. I'm going to call the meeting of the Green Mountain Care Board to order. My name is Kevin Mullen, Chair of the Board. Many people have asked if we would proceed with today's meeting. We felt that it was necessary to proceed, and we as a board have been working remotely all week, and except for two people coming into the office, keeping complete distances. We're still open to public comment and to everything else. And I just want to say before we get started in today's business that it's a very strange world which everybody is trying to deal with right now. And yes, we are going to continue with today's meeting and take up the guidance, but the reality is that we are going to probably have to delay a lot of things, especially the first timetable when it comes to hospital budgets is non-financial reporting, which makes no sense for us to ask hospitals to do that rather than do what they need to do to prepare for the public in case we do have a larger scale outbreak in Vermont. And many believe that it's only a matter of time. Fortunately, the state of Vermont has taken some very good precautions to start to get everybody to, as much as possible, work from home, to follow strict guidelines. Restaurants are closed, schools are closed, and you know, we have to really show some compassion to our neighbors, especially those who aren't as fortunate as those of us who are able to work remotely through technology. And we know that if you're a worker at a restaurant or a movie theater or a hotel or any place of public gathering, that you're going to have a lot of uncertainty. We hope the federal government moves quickly to provide some resources to everyone in the country. But in the meantime, we as state employees will continue to work via remote, and we will continue to move forward. But I just want to say up front that we will not just stick to what's happened in the past. If it's our main job now to get out of the way of the people providing direct care, and even though we are proceeding with guidance, we have to understand that we may have to put in place delays and that we're going to have to play this week by week, day by day, and I don't want any hospital to think that we have not heard what they are going through. I've had conversations with both the head of the VOS board and with Jeff Thiemann, the executive director for VOS, and made it clear that we wish to help, not hinder, and that this is not a time for overregulation. This is a time for understanding and trying to help our neighbors and try to help hospitals through this process. It's going to be a tough process because in order to fully prepare, hospitals are having to make changes. They're canceling elective surgeries. They're seeing a number of people canceling on their own from events that would occur at a hospital. And in some cases, hospitals are going to have to shut down profit centers in order to create the capacity to take care of COVID-19 patients. So we understand all that, but at the same time, we're going to move forward with today's meeting. And at this point in time, I'm going to ask Abigail to take an inventory of anybody who's participating so that we can keep it for the public record. Abigail?
Yes, good afternoon. I'm going to just list out phone numbers that I have on our Skype invite. Please say your name, your title, and your organization after I say the four digits of your telephone number. And there looks like quite a few, so I'll try to do this as quick as possible. Phone number 6778.
Are you using the last four digits?
Yeah.
Great.
Good afternoon, Matt D'Agostino. I'm the manager of contracting and payer relations for the UVM Health Network.
Welcome, Matt.
Thank you.
Thank you.
5001.
Julia Shaw with the Office of the Healthcare Advocate.
Welcome, Julia.
Thank you.
Thank you.
2449.
Kathy Fulton, VPQHC.
Welcome, Kathy.
Thank you.
2505. Jennifer Collis, Government Relations at UVM Medical Center.
Welcome, Jennifer.
Thank you. 6376.
Hi, this is Mort Wasserman. I'm a private citizen professor emeritus of pediatrics at UVM.
Welcome, Mort.
7438.
This is Ham Davis.
Welcome, Ham. Hope all is well.
Doing fine, Kevin. Thank you.
0915.
Jocelyn Bolduc with the Association of Hospitals and Health Systems.
Welcome, Jocelyn.
3082.
Herman Austin, UVM Health Network, contracting.
0043.
This is Becky Lewandowski with DRM.
Welcome, Becky.
I'm sorry, I lost my place. Did I just say 0043 or 2636?
Yes, you did.
8878. Okay.
Jen Bertrand, Chief Financial Officer, Porter Medical Center.
Welcome, Jen.
0193.
Hey, this is Jeff Batista from the State Auditor's Office.
Welcome, Jeff.
5835-4675.
That's Lori.
Thank you. 8643.
Patrick Rooney, Director of Health System Finance.
1970.
I think that's the office here.
Great. 8267.
Lucy Guerin, DRM.
3000.
Somebody calling in from the University of Vermont Medical Center.
Yeah.
This is Mark, but my name is listed further down as an individual name, not a number.
Okay, perfect. Thanks, Mark. 5572. Thank you. 7081.
This is Eric from the HCA.
Thanks, Eric. And it does look like we have a couple people that it recognizes. I see Susan Aronoff is on the phone. And Mark Stanislaw and John Olson.
Well, welcome everyone.
Yes.
So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Susan Barrett for the executive director's report.
So I'm sorry, Howard Weiss-Tisman from VPR is here as well. I don't know why my number didn't show up, but for the sake of clarity, I am here.
Welcome, Howard.
Hi there.
Okay, so at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Susan Barrett for the executive director's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, the board, and the public. Thank you for joining us online and on video under these very unusual and difficult days that we're all experiencing. But I just will echo what our chair said is, you know, for our hospitals, especially being out there on the front lines, we know that you're preparing and you're doing everything you possibly can to get us through this crisis. So I'm going to echo and agree with everything the chair said. Thank you, Kevin, for addressing that. I do want to, related to these unusual times, I want everyone to make sure you check our press release and our scheduling for the month on our website. I mentioned it earlier, but if you go to the Green Mountain Care Board page, right on the landing page, there is the board meeting material information, and if you click on that, you'll see the meetings for the of March, as well as the agendas and the materials for each of the meetings in March. We already have a scheduling change that I want to announce. Our meeting schedule has not been updated yet on the website, but for next week, we're actually conducting a certificate of need hearing, and we'll start that at 9:30 a.m. That is located on our monthly spreadsheet. But in addition to that, if you scroll down to the second page, we have in the afternoon scheduled an FY 2021 hospital budget guidance and potential vote, as well as a presentation from Blue Cross Blue Shield. The FY 2021 hospital budget guidance potential vote, we're going to move up to the morning, since we'll have the CON, we'll put that on the agenda after the CON, and then we are taking off the agenda for now the Blue Cross Blue Shield presentation. As I said, all of this will be updated on our website and on our agendas, but I wanted to mention that and just remind folks to please look at our website, to look at what is on our agenda and where how we are conducting the meetings. I'm assuming we'll be doing this remotely for a while. I also just want to remind everyone to please mute their lines. It sounds like the lines are fine right now, but oftentimes you can get some feedback if you are on the phone and the computer. So please mute your lines unless you're talking and unless you're a board member. And then the last thing I want to just mention is that if we do get disconnected, the number for this call-in is on our agenda and is also on the presentation that we will see here today and on our website. So if the video does go down, which it's been running fine for us so far, but as the day progresses, it may get busier on the bandwidth and we may run into problems. So I just want to remind everyone to use the call-in number supplied on the agenda today. And that is all I have to report. I'll turn it back to you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Susan. The next item on the agenda are the minutes of Wednesday, March 11th. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
So it's been moved and seconded to approve the minutes of Wednesday, March 11th, without any additions, deletions, or corrections. Is there any discussion? Thank you. So at this point, we're going to turn it over to the Hospital Systems Finance team, along with members of our analytics team. And I understand that Agatha Kessler will be driving the slides, but Patrick, I'm going to turn it over to you. And the discussion is on the 2021 hospital budget guidance. Patrick?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to do my best to describe myself. Again, it's Patrick Rooney with the Mountain Care Board, and my colleague Agatha Kessler will be presenting today. From our data, we will have Sarah Lindberg and Lindsay Kill. The guidance discussion for today is going to come in three parts. Part one will be the data team's presentation to the board. Following that, around the patient flow analysis and total cost of care work that they've been doing. After that, we would like to hear from board members in a discussion relating to whether or not they see value in adding this component to the budget, or would it be more of a support and supplemental document for their edification and better informing the decisions they're ultimately going to have to make later this year. Moving past that, we will actually get into the revised draft of the budget guidance with feedback from last week at our meeting. And Sunday, this slide, taking an input and a status of those requests. And the reason we did that was because of some of the technical issues surrounding today's meeting. And if we don't have to toggle back and forth and confuse any line, we'd rather not do so. So if there are specific items, once we get to that board members would like us to highlight using the actual guidance document appendices, we're happy to do so. Moving from there, we review updated policies that part of the guidance, and then after that wraps up the entire discussion, we'll do a board discussion on the MPR FPP growth for the coming year. And after that, we'll cover enforcement and the sustainability plan. So we have a lot to discuss today. And with that, Agatha, if you could move into the next slide, I will turn it over to Sarah Lindberg and Lindsay Kill from our data team.
All right. Yeah, good afternoon. This is Sarah Lindberg, Health Services Researcher with the Green Mountain Care Board. I'm on slide 5 of the presentation today. And what we would like to do is talk about 3 new reports that we're in the process of producing to help support. Okay, so the plan today will walk you through these 3 new reports that we're going to be producing to help support hospital budget processes. And as Patrick alluded to, I think the question before you is how much of this should be material to help respond to questions versus being embedded in the guidance. Now I have lost the presentation, but I am nimble like that. So there it is. Okay, so the first report is what we're calling patient origin, and that report, we'll go into more detail about each of these, but the patient origin report is probably the most closely aligned with the hospital budget process, and that's talking about hospital utilization over time for all patients discharged from the regulated hospitals, and that is sourced from our VUDS data set, the Vermont Uniform Hospital Discharge data set. The second report is most closely aligned with our all-payer model work, and that is one that is called the all-payer model total cost of care. And that was included in last year's guidance, and it's been refined a little bit to include some additional detail by payer, but that is comparing per member per month total cost of care as defined by the all-payer model for the HSA of residents, the hospital service area of residents. And the final report is brand new, and we're very excited about it. And that is one where we're kind of doing a crosswalk that compares the total medical claim spending that we have available to us in VQRs and mapping that from where people live to where the dollars were spent or the hospital service area of the rendering provider. So I think with that, we can move to slide 6. So here's a draft example of what the patient origin report will look like, and we're still kind of refining exactly the best way to deliver these reports. But just to walk you through how this would work, this is an example for CVMC, and the map on the left is showing for both inpatient and outpatient discharges. So discharges are much different than a claim. It's an event-based data collection, what proportion of utilization came from each HSA. So you can see 91% of the discharges at CVMC were from patients residing in the Barry Hospital Service Area. And we'll also have breakouts that show it by payer. This is the table on the right is showing by fiscal year in payer type, and this will be the primary payer type. So of those, vast majority of discharges from Barry, you can see in the first line on the far right for fiscal year 2019, 46% of those were primarily commercial payers. So we'll have one of these where you can kind of compare across the system, but also within each HSA. So this will probably either be an Excel spreadsheet that people can manipulate, or in some sort of interactive visualization, or perhaps both. But we just wanted to kind of give you a flavor of what this report will look like. And if you want to advance to slide 7, please. I want to just highlight some of the strengths and limitations of this particular report. So the strengths that we see are that it's provider-based. So this is the only one of these new reports that is based on where the care is delivered. Which is how the hospital budget process works. So, you know, no matter where the patients come from, the hospitals still are having to address the costs and expenses associated with that care. It also is the only one of the reports that will feature all patients. So it doesn't have the limitations of our all-payer claims database features. So we'll have people who self-pay, we'll have workers' compensation, and the self-funded GoBay decision does not affect these data. It's also data that's submitted directly by hospitals through a contract we have with the Hospital Association NSO branch.
And so they work with hospitals to help, you know, curate this data, but it's coming right from the hospitals, which I think is a real strength of this particular data source. However, nothing's perfect in this world, so the limitations are that we don't really have logical financial data in this data set. It only has charged amounts, which is not very helpful for a budget review. And we only have the facility portion of utilization. So this will come up particularly when an outpatient practice is owned by a hospital. We'll only see the facility side of that claim. So we're going to be a little bit limited on what we can infer on the outpatient utilization side of things. So that's this report. Before we move on to the next, any questions I can address?
Hi, Sarah. It's Maureen. Just a question on, would we be able to get the number of patients when you go back to the slide prior? I guess if we look at the...
So it will be the number of discharges. Counting unique patients is one of those things that seems like it should be so easy. and we're working on refining, but it's unique events. So your high flyers will be, you know, 80%, you know, the 80-20 rule. So we'll have, you know, the same person counted multiple times. So we don't have a distinct count of patients, but we're actively trying to think through a better way to address that issue.
And then just to be clear for anyone that's looking at this chart, this is just not real data, for example. Correct?
Like Pardon?
This isn't live data?
It's not live, no, but it's the most recent we have, so it's through fiscal year 19.
But it doesn't, like if you look at the Brattleboro line, so how would we translate that?
So this is just for CVMC. Maybe it would be helpful, Sarah, to explain what the numbers for HSAs are.
Sorry about that. You would have another chunk that looks like this for Brattleboro Hospital. So not a lot of people, it turns out, seek care at CVMC from the Brattleboro HSA. All right. So the next report, again, is the All-Care Model Total Cost of Care report. So this is refined from last year's budget process. So what we've included here, and again, this is just a draft example, and we're just featuring the Barry HSA. It's always fun to pick on the hometown HSA, but what we have here is the all-payer total cost of care over time, including a five-year compounding annual growth rate. So that would be the growth from 2013 to 2018, which is the most recent complete data we have available for that particular measure. This is on a calendar year basis. We have removed any non-claims-based portion of that because I think that muddies it a little bit when we're trying to do this. I should say we are including the Medicaid all-inclusive population-based payment and the Medicare fee-for-service equivalents, but we are not including any shared savings or blueprint money. It's basically what it boils down to. And here we've also now added breakout by payer type. So you can see statewide, you can see the total cost of care for the commercial, Medicaid, and Medicare populations, as well as what proportion of the kind of payer mix that is for the state. So in 2018, the Medicare total cost of care was $869 per member per month for the claims-based total cost of care, which represented 27% of the 5.4 million member months. Making up the statewide total cost of care. And then you can see below the what it looks like just for people who live in Barrie. So this is, again, another important detail, but this doesn't mean that these people would attribute to the Barrie Health Service Area. That's based on where the rendering provider practices to whom someone attributes. But for those who live in Barrie, this is what their total cost of care has looked like over time. And we can actually go to the next slide, which would be slide 9, which will do a similar strength and limitation review. So the strength of this report is that it's the most aligned with our all-payer model agreement, which is, you know, one of the major mechanisms we're doing to try and meet the triple aim of healthcare delivery reform. And the nice part about this report is that it does factor in people who don't utilize care. So that means we can calculate rates. That's one of the trickier things in my book for a provider-based analysis is it's really more difficult to figure out an appropriate denominator. But since it's based on where people live, we can actually compute meaningful rates. It's also, some of the limitations are we're not restricting by provider, so the total cost of care is going to include care from wherever it's delivered. So people who are getting care out of state are factored into this. So you may live in the Barry HSA but get care down in Boston. So it wouldn't necessarily be a fair reflection of Vermont hospitals in a case like that. Another limitation is that our all payer claims database has certain exclusions. So we are missing people without insurance. We don't have people from out of state that are seeking care in our hospitals. And we have, you know, about half our self-funded market is not reporting to VCARES, although I want to give a shout out to some of the employers who are now agreeing to voluntarily submit thanks to the board's outreach. You know, the more data we're able to get in this thing, the stronger it is. Furthermore, the total cost of care is a more limited scope of services than those provided by hospitals. This is most substantial for our Medicaid population, where about half of the Medicaid care is excluded in the all-payer total cost of care. The other major one that always comes out in my mind is retail pharmacy. So drugs and supplies that are not paid for through medical claims are not in our total cost of care. So any questions about this report before I turn it over to Lindsay to describe our final report? Okay, take it away, Lindsay.
Hi, this is Lindsay Kill. Can everyone hear me?
We can.
Great, thank you so much. So today I'm going to present, talk about briefly the patient migration analysis, which we are adding into the mix. New this year. The table before you is an excerpt from one of the tables we are proposing to include. So this is not a complete table, and this is not the only table we would propose. This is an excerpt of the portion of total medical spend for patients from their home hospital service area, so where their zip code points to in terms of hospital service area, and showing where their medical spend occurred in terms of the hospital service area that the rendering provider was located in. And we also summarize these by the patient insurance records. And this is all for 2018 in this particular chart. But this is coming from our VCARES database. So this is along what Sarah said, this is for everyone who has claims and whose claim submitters submit to VCARES. One example of how we would interpret what we're looking at here is the Middlebury HSA residents spent approximately 48% of all of their medical costs within their own HSA. And if you could click to the next slide, slide 11. I'm just going to go over quickly the strengths and limitations of this data. So the strength of this data set is that it is all medical claims. This includes a broader scope of services than what's included in our all-payer model total cost of care and those captured in the hospital discharge data set. This includes the resident and the provider information. We are mapping where patients live to where their expenditures occurred. So this is really showing a high-level pattern of care that we can compare HSAs to each other and across time. The limitations of this, of course, is that it's not restricted to hospitals. This will include all care for providers in the hospital service area, but that limits its application for hospital budgets. This is all payer claims data only. So again, the people that are not included in here are those self-pay, those from out of state, or in any self-funded group that are not reporting. And lastly, we have some limited services. Because we're only using the all-payer claims database, we do not have non-claims-based spending. Are there any questions about this data?
Okay, I think we can take it back to talk about the last slide, which is slide 12.
So just our next steps on this work stream are that we'll make these reports available on our website. And as always, we will include downloadable data sets so that people can manipulate them in whatever way they see fit. We will refresh these reports annually at a minimum. And we may incorporate additional detail, but we just need to balance those requests with other planned analytical priorities. We're really trying to work on honoring a lot of complex analyses coming up, so just want to make sure that any additional information is balanced with that workload. So I think with that, that would conclude our portion of the presentation, so we're happy to address any questions or concerns before we turn it back over to Patrick and his team.
Questions for Sarah or Lindsay, anyone?
I just wanted to say thanks to both Sarah and Lindsay. This is information we've been looking forward to, so it's good to get a little snapshot.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Lindsay and Sarah. We appreciate you taking the time to help us present that. So not that it has to be done now, but before the final vote, the Health Systems Finance team would like some direction from the board on as to whether or not that information should be included in the budget. So my ask would be that you please take that into consideration between now and the final vote. Next, we will move on to slide 13, titled Draft Number 2, Budget Guidance, for everyone at home. So this is the inventory that I spoke of earlier, where on the left-hand side, you will see where and in which document the requests last week were made. And on the right, you will see the status of those requests, whether they were included or whether it's something that we already asked for and analyzed or what have you. So I will touch on a couple here right away. And one was Board Member Yusufer's gross charge, change in charge chart in the appendix. She had asked if that was something that we could do, and the staff thinks it would be best to revisit that post-budget. So for next year, we want to ensure that all parties understand the information being compiled and that it's accurate so that we don't provide any misleading looks for our hospitals. So that one we are proposing that we move to the next cycle. Moving down, we have the part two narrative. It's number 3 from the bottom, ACO participation in healthcare reform. And this was an item that both Board Member Yusufer and Board Member Pelham had inquired about as to gauging where the hospitals are with their NPR FDP ramp up and where they fall in time frame of getting further and further on into the all-payer model. And we recommend that we further discuss this with other teams like our ACO and policy team. And also, perhaps we pose a question similar to that when we send out the staff analysis later in the budget process so that we can begin to get a feel for where the hospitals are without actually putting that in the guidance this year. So that's the status of that and how we're proposing it. Underneath that is the healthcare advocates, items that go along with some of their questions, and we had sought them out earlier this week to ask some historical information could be folded up that's already been asked. And what I did see before we came on the meeting that I got a reply from Julia Shaw, healthcare advocate. I've not had a chance to read that yet, so there could be some information in there that I'm not privy to. At the very bottom under general is a payer reimbursement assessment tool. We have been working on this. This is a commercial to Medicare charge ratio and Medicaid to Medicare charge ratio. It was originally brought up in last year's budget hearings, and we've been working with the hospitals to refine what that is. And that's something that we can offer as a support tool for our board members as we receive budgets from the hospital. The remainder are items that we accepted and included in either the appendices or the off-cycle reporting or made red line changes to in the narrative. Now, again, the reason for this inventory is so we could limit the toggling back and forth between those various documents and the presentation here. So at this point, I would pause and ask board members if there's any item on here that you would like us to show you in those documents we can certainly do that. So Agatha has direction on where to go from here.
Board members?
No, this is Maureen. I also had talked with the budget team and I'm in agreement with moving some of the requests I had to next year. So just want to concur with that.
Thank you, Maureen. Any other board members?
Go ahead, Tom.
Well, this is just a short one, and it's not specific to these items. It was when Patrick introduced him, he was interested in what the board might think about the A-team's presentation being included. And I'm just wondering if he could give me a couple more sentences on that, since this is work that we're doing, and it may or may not be helpful information to hospitals. What would be a reason that we wouldn't include it as available information in the process?
So we talked with the A team. We discussed, as you saw, the kind of the benefits and the limitations of the information. And we just want to make sure that if it's something that you all want to keep paying attention to as it refines, then that's great. And our question was, does it belong in their budget process this year? Does it influence any of the decisions they're making as far as building budget, or is it just a supplementary thing? So we just want to know, because it's new information, not everyone at the hospital has seen it yet, what direction would the board like the staff to go with this? Because we want to make sure that you have every available component of information to make the best informed decision that you can. But this information is very new, and we want to be conscious of the fact that there are limitations to it. So we don't want to supply anything that could potentially misinform. So if the board sees value in having this added to a component of the budget submission, please let us know where you would like that document to be placed, and and we can go from there.
This is Patrick. Jessica. This is Agatha. Do you mind if I follow up on that question from Tom?
Please.
Just from a budget guidance perspective, the question would be, do we include a question or a series of questions related to the materials you just saw, or do we have it be a supplemental document that's used after the budgets are submitted? So that's kind of why Patrick is posing that question right now as we're looking at the budget guidance.
This is Jessica, can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Just in my own thoughts on this, I'd like to share, I think that the materials that the A-team put together, these reports are fantastic. I think they will help us shape kind of a better understanding of what's happening in each HSA. I look at them in the same way that I think about the payer reimbursement assessment tool that's on the bottom of the table that Patrick was just going through. But I think at this point, our hospitals are inundated with caring for patients in the community. And my sense is adding more questions to guidance is not prudent right now. I think that we can certainly use this data and understand the limitations of the data as we're understanding their budgets and their budget submissions, and certainly sharing any of these data reports with the hospitals and the general public will be useful, but I would not advocate adding more questions to the budget guidance right now.
Thank you for that, Jess, because I think that this is a year that we have to be very sensitive about how much work is being created for hospitals as they're dealing with what we're all experiencing out there. So. I appreciate those words and comments from you.
So this is Robin, I'll jump in. I agree with Jess. I think the guidance needs to be clear that we may consider it as background information, but I don't want to ask any additional questions. I think one of the things that is a little bit hard for me in thinking through this presentation right now is that as Kevin said at the beginning, we haven't really yet had a chance to talk about kind of what we're thinking about in terms of moving forward. And so I for me, there's like basically two ways to go or two potential ways to go. And one of them would be just pushing the whole process. The other would be skinnying down the process. And I don't think we know today what we should do or what makes sense given the situation. So I think this looks fine with the caveat that depending on where we end up with the emergency and how long that lasts, we may have to revisit the guidance. I think we may have to revisit the guidance in the future.
So whoever is not on mute that has the background noise, if you could put it on mute, it would be very helpful. To follow up on what Robin has said, one thing that I'm pretty clear on today, and I might be wrong, and I hope I'm wrong, but it appears that the non-financial reporting should probably not occur in the next few months. And I would like to get feedback from the board at some point on where the rest of the board stands on that. But I don't think this is the time for us to take valuable time and resources away from the efforts in the field.
This is Jessica. I agree.
It's Maureen. I agree as well.
Tom or Robin?
This is Tom. I'm on board with that. I think, you know, as people refer to this black swan that has, you know, come our way, that, you know, the amount of upheaval that we anticipate, we don't even know. And so if I were, you know, to go in a direction, I would go in the one that Robin suggested, which is less is more at this point in time. But on the other hand, if there are opportunities out here to improve the existing infrastructure that we have as a friendly part of this process, you know, I wouldn't be totally closed to it, but my general sense would be people are up to their ears in alligators, and less is more here.
Yeah, I agree too. I mean, as one of the people who probably most heavily uses the non-financial reporting, I feel like, you know, it's just we'll figure it out, but we shouldn't be asking people to submit anything by May 1st. I had another thought on the timelines, and I don't know if this is the right time to throw it out there, Kevin, or if you want me to wait until we're farther along with the presentation.
Well, I'll let you use your good judgment. If it's along the conversation that we just had, throw it out. But if it's relative to what's further on in the documents, then wait.
It's specifically relevant to the timeline. And so one of the questions that I posed to Mike a few minutes ago, and I apologize to him for not throwing it out there sooner, but it just really, my thinking evolved this morning, was whether or not in the budget guidance document itself, where we have the timelines laid out, if we should, instead of having specific guidelines, basically delegate authority as a board to you, Kevin, as the chair, to determine the guidelines as appropriate, which gives more flexibility to figure it out in real time as we get more information. We also, one thing we did look at is the guidance by our rule. It has to be issued by the 31st, but that is not in statute, and we do have the authority, as long as it's not routine, to waive our own rule. So I would also wonder if it might make sense, and I'll just throw it out there, to waive that the rule of the 31st for guidance, which would give us more time to see how things evolve and determine whether it makes sense to push the whole process within statutory limitations or to skinny the process if we're not able because of the statutory limitations. And I'll just note on that piece, the main statutory limitation is that by law, we're required to make a decision by September 15th. There is currently a bill in Senate Health and Welfare related to COVID-19, and and they will be thinking about whether or not to give us the authority to waive that. But that's not law now. So that's what I was going to throw out there.
Maybe you might want to put that into a much simpler motion.
Well, could we discuss first whether or not people would be open to pushing the guidance, waiving the March 31st rule to push the guidance beyond that date? Maybe that's the first question.
Okay.
And maybe we want Mike to weigh in on that.
Mike Barber, are you capable of weighing in at this point?
Yeah. I agree with everything Robin said. She kind of captured our discussion. The rule gives the board the authority to waive provisions of the rule to prevent unnecessary hardship or delay, to prevent injustice or for other good cause. And so, like Robin said, the March 31st date for the guidance is in the rule. It's not in the statute. So if you guys feel that one of those conditions is met, if there's good cause to waive that, you can do that.
And I guess my thinking is I don't want to create more uncertainty in terms of the process, but given the amount of uncertainty out there, it just seems like if we're not able to shift the statutory deadline, I think realistically we're going to have to skinny down the guidance significantly from where it is today, and just really pick what we focus on. So that's why I think maybe pushing it makes sense, so we have a better idea of which of those two options are available to us.
This is Maureen. I don't have an objection to moving it out. However, I think we will need to find out, you know, get an understanding of how long we want to move it out, what that's going to mean and things like that, because, you know, we don't want to push it out for whether it's a month, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, and then turn around and say, okay, we want all the information by, you know, September and things like that. So I think we need to probably have some discussions with the hospitals on some framework and things like that. My concern would be we move it out 2 weeks and then we don't change everything dramatically down the road as to what the deliverables are and things like that. So it may even create more uncertainty knowing that, you know, we could set the guidance right now on the path that we're going on and understand that, yes, things are in flux and could change, you know, very quickly down the road. So, you know, I'd also just like to hear other people's perspective on that as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that, there's a lot unknown here. And in the context of all that unknown, we need to be agile. And I think that the board has a very collegial relationship. We're all interested in doing the right thing. You know, I think Kevin has his ear to the ground in terms of issues that arise and what's going on out in the hospital land. And so I would be open not bending the rules here, but amending the rule that applies this year so that we can move quickly. But then you get into this issue of the open meeting law, you know, where we, you know, three of us can't be in the same room at the same time. So I'm shooting my argument in the foot here, but I would go the agile route as best as we could within our statutory guidelines.
Hey, Stephanie. So I guess in my mind, we want to maximize flexibility, and I think we want to minimize uncertainty for the hospitals and minimize the burden for them right now as they're trying to manage a public health crisis. So we need to be nimble, I think. I'd be in favor of waiving that aspect of the rule. But I hear what Maureen is saying in terms of we don't want to add more uncertainty to any process because uncertainty is problematic. So I think we want to convey that somehow, some way, that hospitals will have enough. We're trying to help the hospitals in this process by doing this, by streamlining guidance and having flexibility with the guidance and in the deadlines to minimize their burden as they're trying to deal with the public health crisis.
So, Robin, I would like to throw the question out to Vaz about their opinion on this. And it may be unfair to put Jocelyn on the spot, but maybe you could phrase some type of motion and then I could go to public comment if there's a second.
Sure. So I move that the board waive its rule that hospital budget guidance must be issued by March 31st.
Yep, I'll second it.
So it's been moved and seconded. At this point in time, I'm going to open it up for public discussion. Is there someone from Vaz that would like to address this issue, or possibly one of the hospital CFOs that's on the line?
So first of all, thank you for taking up this important conversation at this time, you know, with the uncertainty that we're all dealing with. I mean, the health networks support creating the most flexible, feasible process for the budget. As it's been said earlier, we think it's important, as the board members consider this decision and some others coming up in the near term, that to just understand the current priorities of the hospital, hospitals. I mean, the first priority of the hospitals to deal with this public health crisis, as stated. The second is to maintain some stability to our employees and our communities that we serve. And in doing so, this is also going to create potentially a financial crisis on the hospitals. While it may not challenge immediate solvency, it is going to stress whether a number of hospitals close to covenant violations within their current debt structures. And that could potentially affect any of the hospitals in the state of Vermont, if not all of them. Like, I can tell you, our focus is first on the public health crisis, is next, how do we promote stability to our employees and our communities in certain times? And we're keeping an eye on the downstream impacts that this could have for the end of the fiscal year on our covenant violations or covenant testing, in hope to avoid any covenant violations, and that might require some immediate action now. And from a budget perspective for FY21, I candidly have to say that is way down the list right now. So it is difficult, at least from the hospital perspective or the budget perspective, to say how we would respond to anything that the Green Mountain Care Board puts out, but that's where our priorities are. So we would obviously promote as much flexibility as possible within the guidance of the rules and the statute. But, you know, I can't speak for all the hospitals, but I can speak for a few of them. At least the FY21 budget is, like, down on our priority list. It's still very important, but it is way down on the list right now.
And we understand that it has to be your number one priority, the COVID addressing, and I think that's the real intent of the motion that came from Member Lunge, is to try to put some more flexibility and nimbleness into the process, Mark. Was that Jen that I heard start to speak?
Yes, it is, Chair Mullen. It's Jen Bertrand. I would certainly echo what Mark is saying, and I will caution that myself, stepping in as section chiefs, as part of incident command, who oversee other areas as CFOs, such as supply chain, which, as you can imagine, has quite a strain on it currently. It's certainly taking up perhaps some of the smaller organizations' CFO time and try to focus on those budgets. In addition to, unfortunately, we have members of our own teams, I can speak to some here at Porter, who are now at home. We're trying to have them obviously set up to work from home, but are ill, not with the COVID piece of this, but just as precautionary, having them stay at home, which then creates a little bit of bandwidth issues, as you can imagine, and taking away focus from the budget process. So those are, you know, just some of the outlying things that we're focusing on. I'll be frank, since March 9th, this is the first time I've been able to focus on anything budget-related, if that helps. And so we certainly appreciate anything the board is doing to help with those delays so we can focus on the immediate need at hand.
And as several of us have said, Jen, already, that we want to help, not hinder.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. All that you're doing. And there was an excellent front page picture of the Porter drive-thru on the cover of the Rutland Herald this morning. So.
Yes, and it's quite busy, as you can imagine.
We're getting a glimpse of what life is like for you. Are there other members of the public who wish to comment?
Hi, this is Devin Green from the Vermont Association of Hospitals and Health Systems.
Hey, Devin.
And I just got texted about what was happening, so I hope I'm commenting on the right thing, but we do support waiving the deadline for hospitals.
Great. That wasn't what we were talking about, but that's okay. No, I'm just kidding, Devin. Just kidding.
Oh my God.
Trying to add some levity into some trying times.
It is trying times, for sure.
Yeah.
But yes, I really appreciate your efforts on that, and it will alleviate a lot, at least one piece of the pressure that hospitals are dealing with right now.
Okay, is there other public comment?
Kevin, Mike Fisher here.
Hey, Mike.
Mike Fisher, healthcare advocate. I think that the approach that's laid out in this motion, I also think it makes sense, and I also think it makes sense to further create much nimbleness in the board's decision-making process, apropos of delegating some authority to the chair, so that you guys have a process that can work given the evolving nature of this thing.
Thank you, Mike. Other members of the public? Not hearing anything else. Is there any further comment from board members? Hearing none, Council Barber, could you call the roll on the motion?
Yeah, if I could just restate the motion as I heard it, would be to waive the March 31st deadline for the issuance of hospital budget guidance for fiscal year 2021. Was there also anything about delegation in this motion, or is this strictly the waiver of the timeline?
So I phrased it first as the waiver of the timeline because, just to explain that, I think that would give us either more time what we want to issue with guidance, or we could go ahead and do some delegation today too, but I thought maybe we could take those as separate conversations.
Member Holmes?
Yes.
Member Lunge?
Yes.
Member Usfer?
Yes.
Member Pelham?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Patrick.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And as you all know, but the hospital and the members of the public should know as well, that staff here who have compiled this can adjust and be as flexible as needed as this process evolves, given the current state of events. So with that, we're going to move into slide 14, which is an update of the policies that are part of this process as well, and I will turn that over to Agatha Kessler.
Thank you, Patrick. So we're on slide 14 of the slide deck, and we're actually going to jump to a second document that's posted on the website. We're going to take you to the text of the policies themselves. So for those of you who are following online, you can see the new document up on the screen. For those of you who are using the documents on the website, this is called the combined guidance document, and we are starting on page 15 of that combined guidance document. This is where the policies start. So to review, we're going to go over three policies with you: the exemption from public hearing, the budget adjustment, and appendix 9 is the budget adjustment, and then appendix 10 is for hospitals that are requesting a budget amendment. So back to page 15 on the combined document. The exemption from public hospital budget hearing has not been substantially modified. It's been updated. The piece that has been updated is in the criteria. Staff are suggesting that we include explicit instructions that the budget, in order to qualify for an exemption, would also have to comply with all content and submission requirements. So that's just, we would categorize that as a cleanup addition. Appendix 9 is budget amendments and adjustments. This is an example of how the guidance document was reorganized. We took some policies out of the budget guidance document itself and gave it its own appendix. This policy sets forth when a hospital needs to have an approved budget amended. For example, if in the course of the year they have a provider transfer acquisition, and that same sort of criteria applies for when a hospital would like the board to make an adjustment in their submitted budget. So I guess the best example is if a hospital acquires a practice in February of a fiscal year, we would describe that as a budget amendment. They would have to amend their approved budget order for the current fiscal year. But if a provider transfer happens, let's say in July, we would not amend the current year budget order and instead ask the hospital to include it in their annual budget submission, and it would be considered an adjustment. A new concept here that is something that we'd like to prompt the board to think about is, as staff, we see a variety of interactions and correspondences with the hospitals about things that are potential provider transfers or things that might be an expansion of a service line because of recruitment. And as staff, we see that they vary in scale from small adjustments, adjustments that are less than 1% of NPR, all the way up to larger adjustments. And what we wanted to prompt the board to consider is whether or not the board would like to include any language in these adjustment policies that would capture a reasonableness threshold. So for example, if there's a change at a hospital that is below a certain threshold, then it would not be expected that the hospital would request an amended budget order, although it would be expected that the hospital would report it in the regular monthly year-to-date reporting. So you'll see here that there is a place saver for a threshold figure. This is simply to prompt board discussion on this topic. It does not need to be a specific value. It could be a narrative, so to speak, with words like reasonable or significant, but to flag that issue for the board. Continuing on, we've cleaned up the independent provider acquisition and transfer policy to reflect how the board has used this policy in the past and how the board may want to use this policy in the future. To put it simply, the policy as currently written applies strictly to independent practices that are acquired or transferred to the hospital. So if Dr. Smith is independent one day and then works for the hospital the next day, it would fall into the provider transfer policy. However, as we've seen, the board has come into cases where it's not necessarily that Dr. Smith is practicing one day under one roof and another day under another roof. It could be that Dr. Smith closes the practice and now those patients don't have a home anymore. We've seen where hospitals have then expanded their service lines to respond to that gap in service in the community, and the provider transfer policy has been used. So we've incorporated the word service into this. I think what really captures it here is this highlighted piece that this policy applies to the acquisition of an independent healthcare practice, hospital divestment of a healthcare practice, and a hospital's response to the anticipated gap in service when an independent provider leaves the community. Scrolling down, we've added a new section about accounting adjustments. This is not a new practice. It's just that we're now putting it down in writing that when a hospital has an accounting adjustment that affects their budget, we have a policy now that more clearly defines the expectation to report on those. And then finally, the amendments to approve budgets in Section D is outside of a provider transfer acquisition, a hospital, as you know, can request for an amended budget order. And so we've included this in the overall adjustment policy and have described it as unanticipated changes to an approved budget. For example, request for interim changes in charge or unforeseen changes in utilization. Any questions on the policy of provider of adjustments and amendments?
Questions?
I actually...
Go ahead.
Sorry, Kevin.
Go ahead.
This is Robin. My question was actually on the budget during waiver process. So we had indicated, and we did this the last couple of years, that we weren't doing exemptions. I would think we'd want to give ourselves the flexibility to allow for waiver of budget hearings. So, for example, if we aren't able to give flexibility in the September 15th statutory deadline, but it's not reasonable to do full-blown budget process, we may want to waive some hearings in that kind of, given the circumstances. So I just want to make sure we maintain flexibility there.
I agree with that. I think we should have flexibility to exempt hospitals from the budget hearing if circumstances suggest that that's prudent.
Yeah, I think we need to, when we look at what the criteria is, we already rule out the top four hospitals, and of the remaining 10 hospitals, I'd have to look, but I think most of those 10 are losing money or are missing their budget. So we just have to be careful. It's not that I don't want to put a waiver in place and not review hospitals, but the ones that will be of most concern are the ones that are really hemorrhaging on the bottom line. And so I would be careful about, you know, if they comply with everything, sure, but in the past, some of the ones that have asked for the waiver are the hospitals that are the most financially at risk. So, you know, certainly
I think we're just trying to remove that box in the upper right and just say, I think we want to remove that box, right? Where we're saying there will be no exemptions. I think that's what we want to eliminate. Is that right?
That's what I was thinking, but maybe to Maureen's point, we also want to just make it clear that this policy, like, I'm really thinking, like, not as usual when I'm talking about that box, but also, like, we have to do it by September 15th, but it's not, we just literally don't have enough time to do multiple hospital budget hearings. And so for this 1 year, we're going to just get through it and then go back to a more normal process. So I just want to make sure we can be nimble in an extreme circumstance as well as, you know, as what we would normally do. Because I agree with you, Maureen. Like, I think the small hospitals are probably the ones we really need to see in a normal, if we can do some sort of a normal process this year.
Yeah, I mean, I do think we're going to need flexibility in the whole process. I just want to make sure, as you know, as if I were on the hospital side and I'm going through this, most of the hospitals that are, you know, could qualify because it's not the four largest, almost all of them are losing money, and we would expect that probably will get worse with what's going
right.
on. So we may need to streamline things, but I think we need to be in the loop and informed. And so certainly we can take that off. But
there may be ways also, Maureen, to be flexible so that we're not dragging people to Montpelier. So I think that as long as we keep in mind that we should be keeping flexible, just removing that box shouldn't be that big a deal.
Yep, no, I think that's fine.
Well, I also hope that as our elected federal officials are contemplating relief efforts to certain industries, that they put at the top of the list are frontline healthcare providers. Other discussion?
Okay.
Seeing none,
okay, great. Chairman Mullen, shall I?
Yes.
Okay. So we'll take that feedback on Appendix 8 back to the budget team and Lynn, who is counsel, who's assigned to the hospital budget team, to figure out how we can ensure that there's flexibility in this exemption policy. The last Appendix 10 is about budget performance and enforcement, which is actually the next topic that you'll be hearing from us when we conclude budget guidance. So you'll see this language again shortly. This has been really just for highlighting in number two that the board will have to make a decision on what the acceptable range is in terms of if a hospital has a budget variance greater than X percent, then they would be subject to review. So those were the updates in the policies. Any questions?
Just one comment on this part of the policy. When we look at that number two, you know, where we're focusing on if they're above or below on the NPR, and I think again, 10 of the hospitals were below NPR, and then of those, many had operating losses that were much greater than had been projected. So there might be a way to also incorporate that factor in, meaning if a hospital, I think there may have been one hospital that was below their NPR, but you know, they were able to maintain their profitability. So, you know, that may be one we don't want to look at. So we may want to consider, you know, something like that as well. So if we set up a guideline that said that we're going to look at everybody that was below 3%, but if they were below 3% and they also, you know, were able to maintain their profitability, it wouldn't be as much of a concern. And again, I know we may be, you know, flexible on this due to the timing, but, you know, one of the focuses that we've been looking at the past couple of years has really been those hospitals that were missing the top line and bottom line pretty significantly, and trying to prevent further situations in the future of bankruptcy and things like that. So, but it may be something to think about when we talk about the enforcement discussion.
Okay, other comment? Agatha?
Okay, great. So now we're jumping back to the PowerPoint presentation. This is slide 14 that we're finishing, and we'll move on to slide 15. I'll turn over to you, Patrick.
Thank you. So that wraps up the guidance review portion of the meeting, and now we're going to transition into the NPR FCG growth for the coming year. And up on your screen on slide 15, we have some of what was established in fiscal year 20 budget guidance, and in bold, some of the language that surrounds those decisions. And this is strictly a board driven discussion. We have this up here for you. And on slide 16, we have proposed language for motion. So we can take it back to slide 15 and the actual language that was in the budget guidance from last year and turn it over to the board for discussion on NPR growth for the coming year.
Who would like to start?
I guess I'll go ahead. This is Robin. Given the uncertainty and the happen for the remainder of this fiscal year going into next fiscal year, I think just sticking with, since last year our goal was to set a two-year target, we should just stick with what we had last year, because it sort of undermines the point of establishing a two-year target if we're not sticking with it. So that's my thought, understanding that, you know, the target may get totally thrown out the window given the circumstances.
Other thoughts?
I agree with, this is Tom, I agree with Robin in the sense that it's an unknown and we could restructure this in a number of ways, but many months or a few months down the road kind of look back and say, holy cow, you know, we were looking at 2020 as coming in at certain levels and they're way, way above it, and using that as a base just doesn't make any sense anymore. So I would leave the language in that's there that gives some guidance, but I wouldn't be a diehard about those parameters, because what's going on out there in the field is a total unknown, and the process that we had set up
was one that was set up for a more routine and regular environment, and this is certainly not that.
This is Jessica. I agree. I mean, I think the reason that we set a two-year target was to give predictability to the hospitals. So to the degree, but we're living in a world of unpredictability right now, completely. So, you know, one thing, you know, I'm looking at the slide here and, you know, there was some question about whether we give a two-year growth limit target. And I would say we should just stick to this year and this year alone, because we don't know where we're going to be a month from now, 6 months from now, and certainly a year from now. We don't even know where we're going to be tomorrow, if I'm being frank. And so I think that I'm comfortable with putting a 3.5 if that's what everybody else agrees, because that's what our two-year target had been. But I think we need to add some language in here that recognizes that, you know, there's a situation evolving in terms of a pandemic, and we need to be flexible with respect to the hospital budgets that are submitted and with respect to this NPR cap. I mean, I just think we need to put it in writing that we recognize that the times are changing, and you know, we may put this cap in there, but we recognize what the hospitals are going through right now. So those would be my two cents.
So if I could summarize what I've heard so far, in case somebody wishes to make a motion, is that it would be a one-year target only, that the board recognizes that even setting a one-year target may not be realistic, but is doing so, but will be completely open to dealing with changes as they occur, as hospitals learn more about what they are dealing with, in that in addition to the 3.5% growth limit, there's also the 5% growth limit for hospitals with budget-to-budget variance less than 2%, with the same caveats that it may be irrelevant, but that for the purposes of setting this guidance forward, those are the base parameters. Is somebody willing to make a motion?
I just wanted to say one more thing. I mean, I really hope that whenever the budgets are submitted, if that deadline is extended, my hope is that the budgets that are submitted are based on the circumstances that the hospitals are in, the most up-to-date current information that they have, the most realistic budgets that they can put together at the time. That's what I'm hoping that we see. So if we can convey that as well, I think that's important.
Yeah, I think another factor as well is how are the hospitals altering their process, because we were just one piece of that process. They have a process with their board and with their internal committees about when they're forecasting for the year. And I don't think it's all driven just by the regulatory process. So, you know, understanding what they're doing as well to give them flexibility, but, you know, are they just not doing that, or what are they going to be presenting to their boards, and how are they going to be managing their budgets? Because, you know, I as well am all for the flexibility and moving things out. We also know that a budget is irrelevant from day one and is a forecast, and that they will measure, that they will look to change, you know, each month. And their fiscal year isn't changing, right? So they're starting October 1st, no matter what, right? That's their fiscal year. And they have other things with bank covenants and things like that. So there are requirements that they're going to have as well as far as putting together a budget. So just, you know, putting that into perspective as well. I mean, we can say they don't have to come to us. We can talk about being really flexible. We can talk about moving timelines. But their fiscal year isn't changing. And they're going to come up with actuals through September and a new, you know, and a forecast through October. And I guess, you know, getting a better understanding of what they're going to be doing. I know their focus is going to be on other things, and I know we need to be flexible. At the same time, they have to make sure that they're solvent and that they're putting their forecast, some type of forecast together to understand what's going on. So their fingers also will be on the pulse on this, too. So perfectly happy to be flexible to go with the 3.5. You know, when you look at the language on the last page at the bottom, we do give flexibility to go over 3.5% if it's justified. We opened that up for last year. And I think we've shown that we look at each hospital's individual circumstances when they come in, and that helps to guide the process, you know, as well. So I think we need some more information from the hospital groups as well as about what they're doing with this process.
So, Robin, are you prepared to make a motion?
Yes, I think so. So I move that we, I guess I could do, actually, I guess, could you go back one slide to slide 15? I just want to take a quick look at this. Okay, so here's my first try. We'll see, I may have to do two tries, but I move that we establish growth target and budget to projection variances consistent with the language in the fiscal year 20 budget guidance, with and recognize that the board will be considering the pandemic and emergency circumstances in requests for variances. So I know that's a little vague, but I think that gives us some time to wordsmith the actual language in the guidance.
Is there a second?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Further discussion? If not, again, I'm going to open it up to the public for public comment before we take a vote. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to comment?
Again, this is Devin Green from the Vermont Association of Hospitals and Health Systems, and we do appreciate any flexibility you can offer on this, so thank you.
Thank you, Devin. Other public comment? Seeing none, is there any further board discussion? Otherwise, I'm going to turn it over to Council Barber for a roll call.
Yeah, this is Mike. Could I just ask one clarifying question about the motion?
You may.
Please.
So we're talking, I think, about a one-year target, the second year of the two-year guidance that was issued last year. Is that?
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Okay, so Member Holmes.
Jessica?
Yes.
Member Usfer?
Yes.
Member Lunge?
Yes.
Member Pelham?
Yes.
Mr. Chair?
Yes. Okay, Patrick, back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So on slide 17, we have next steps. Of course, with our discussion today, this slide will, the items on this slide certainly need to be adjusted as we wait for board or legislative direction on guidance and the final vote, et cetera, and whatnot. So we'll move past that now and move into the enforcement discussion. And again, I will turn it over to Agatha.
Thank you, Patrick. So we are on slide 19 of the slide deck. This is moving directions now for the board away from FY21 budget guidance and talking about FY19 budget performance and enforcement. So what we're gonna do over the next several minutes is review the timeline of enforcement, the policy, refresh you on the FY19 year-end results, which you saw in a February board meeting. We'll show you a couple slides that we're calling enforcement analysis that will show you which hospitals would fall into the different thresholds, and then talk about next steps. So this is language from the FY 2019 budget guidance for budget order. In the FY 2019 budget guidance, the board established a 0.5% threshold, where if a hospital was above 0.5% or below negative 0.5%, that they would be subject to review. to remind the board, in this time last year, the board was looking at a very similar guidance, and they, the board chose to broaden that range to positive 2% down to minus 2.5%. The timeline, as we said, is you reviewed these results at the February 26th board meeting. You're discussing the policy today. You'll be establishing the threshold today, and any hospitals that are subject to the established threshold would be called in April for an enforcement hearing. This slide 21 is a recap of the FY19 results showing the hospital's approved budget, their actual revenue, net patient revenue for the year, their budget variance, and then in the right-hand side, you see their operating margin. Again, reminding the board that the analysis that we've done does not include Springfield Hospital's audited financials. This is using their unaudited financials. This is just a graph showing, it's a visual representation of that same data showing the budget to actual variances. This is a nice look because you can see pretty quickly who's above and who's below. So this is, the next two slides are going to show you hospitals that would be subject to review if you use the plus or minus half a percent trigger, or if you use the plus 2% minus 2.5% range. So with a plus or minus 5%, which is how the guidance is written, you'd be calling in all hospitals or reviewing all hospitals except for Brattleboro Memorial and Porter. And the next slide shows, again, if you're using the 2% to minus 2.5%, in this case, you'd be bringing in a much smaller, or you'd be reviewing a much smaller group of hospitals. The hospitals in blue are the hospitals that would be subject to review.
Do you want to take comment as we go, Agatha, or wait till the end?
Sure. Absolutely.
I would just say that if we're consistent with past practices, a number of these hospitals would really be addressed in next year's budget, not in enforcement, as a significant number are meeting the under threshold and not the over threshold. And it, at least my perspective is that calling anyone in for a budget enforcement hearing within the next month is just totally the wrong thing to do when people are trying to address the crisis at hand. But that's a thought from just one board member.
Yes,
two board members.
We have
three board members.
We have here, Chairman Mullen, the Q1 results for the hospital. So taking a look beyond the FY19 year end, which concluded September of 2019, as you can see, it's a different look for some of these hospitals if you're looking at their first year or their first quarter results for this fiscal year. So we wanted you to be able to see that side by side. This is what brings them the decision before you today in terms of their budget variance versus how they're actually doing this year. The one that really calls stands out is Northeastern as the one hospital that exceeded their budget variance by 3.8%. As you can see in the first quarter of the year, they're minus 4.0. This last slide, and this is very much in line with your comments, is that as staff, what we're recommending at a minimum is to expand the trigger above the half percent to consider that Q1 year-to-date performance, to consider operating margins, where these hospitals stand in terms of their financial health, but also to consider the amount of work that's already being done to monitor the hospitals in terms of the monthly monitoring and the sustainability plan, so that, to some extent, supports what you just expressed. At this point, it's up for committee discussion.
So again, I'll start off the discussion just by saying that I don't think that any enforcement hearing in April is appropriate, and I believe that we could deal with any problems that we see during the budget process, and now's not the time to be penalizing anyone. With that, I'll open it up to the rest of the board.
This morning, First, also on staff recommendations, and somehow my Skype knocked me out like right as Kevin was talking, so I think someone's pushing me off this on the budget piece, but on the staff recommendations, I'd also like to see where, and I sent you guys an email on this, where their 19 actual came in versus their 19 projections. So just to understand if things got better or worse from their projections when they submitted the 20 budget, I think would also be a good thing to look at. You know, as far as bringing in for enforcement hearings in April, I agree that's not the time to do it. I would say, though, you know, the hospitals that concern me the most are the ones, the 10 hospitals that are missing their budgets. And I think it would be good also to look at what their operating margin budget was compared to where their actuals were. We can see their actuals are in the red for most of those hospitals. And I don't, you know, I think part of this isn't trying to penalize the hospitals. It's trying to look at those hospitals that are missing their top line budgets and their bottom line budgets and entered 20 with potentially unrealistic forecasts on the top line, you know, it's just going to continue to lose on the bottom line. Obviously now we have a lot of other circumstances that aren't going to help that, but understanding what ramifications that could have for some of these hospitals, again, that are losing, you know, 5 to 10% each year. So,
and I would just say on that, Maureen, that of those hospitals that are in that situation, they're all, I believe that every single one of them is under the current monitoring system that's been in place, with Patrick, Lori, and myself having conversations with them on a regular basis. And I think that, you know, when you look at strides that have been made, you know, once in a while it's good to do a good pat on the back. And in a year ago at this time, if we had to say a hospital that we were truly, truly worried about would have been Gifford, and yet Gifford has managed to bring in a positive operating margin, they're still struggling with their revenue side, but that still is something that is a true accomplishment. And I think that we can deal with it with that monitoring, letting Patrick and Lori try to offer any assistance to them, but without trying to call them in and create uncertainty for them and spend time on preparing for a hearing. That's kind of where I'm not saying that we're trying to penalize them. I'm just saying that sometimes we need to, as regulators, get out of the way, because this is really an existential or an exogenous event that we need to be helpful and not hurtful on.
No, I agree with that. And Gifford was the hospital I was talking about that came in lower on the top line, but was able to make other adjustments to actually improve where their bottom line was coming in. I mean, the key thing we know at a lot of these hospitals, their fixed expenses can't really move too much. And so once they put in where they think they're going to be on the top line, they build their staffing to that level, they miss the top line, they miss the bottom line, and it continues to happen. And so I think, right, your monitoring is helpful with that. So I'm okay with that. I'm just saying I think we need to be at least understand also where they came out versus their forecast for 19, and then looking at what that means for 20 and what that changes for 20 for the full year.
Other board members?
Yeah, this is Jessica. So I agree with you, Kevin, that bringing any hospital in for enforcement right now is not the right step, and we need to get out of the way and let the hospitals do what they need to do to care for the patients that are going to be coming in the door. I will say, when this passes, and I believe it will, and I'm optimistic that it will, I am worried about the hospitals on the other end of this. We can expect shortages in supplies, shortages in staff, driving up costs more than they have been already. Revenue, as you know, patients are not going into the hospital now for fear of contracting the virus, and hospitals are, you know, restricting or eliminating elective surgeries. Those tend to be high margin surgeries.
So I really do worry about where our hospitals are going to come out on the other end of this. And so the monthly monitoring is going to be important to the extent that they have capacity to be submitting those reports. I think we have to also be flexible on that. Maybe phone conversations, I'm not sure. But, you know, the sustainability plans, when we get to them and when they become, you know, when we can get to them and the hospitals are prepared to do them, are going to be really important. But so I agree with you, Kevin, on the not doing anything enforcement-wise in April or anytime soon.
It's going to be a very challenging year when we actually are able to do the budgets, but also rate review, because one has to assume that there's going to be a pent-up demand for services that are being delayed. And these are all questions that are going to be very difficult for everyone to quantify, and yet we're going to have to try to get through this as best we can. Other thoughts? Robin, Tom?
I agree with Maureen that, you know, we should kind of button up the end of the, and, you know, the 2019 data. But I think anything in 2020 is going to be so one time, and that there's really no basis for enforcement, because this black swan showed up and changed the circumstances completely. So I think that having, you know, a good understanding of kind of what the underlying dynamics were through 2019, and so as kind of a platform, and then 2020, we're just going to have to start kind of from scratch and work our back toward a reasonable trend line.
Robin?
I agree with what everyone has said. I think I don't think enforcement makes sense at this point.
Would someone like to make a motion?
I move we waive enforcement for all hospitals for fiscal year 19.
A second.
Discussion? If not, I'll open it up to the public for public comment.
This is Devin Green from the Vermont Association of Hospitals and Health Systems again. I appreciate waiving the enforcement for hospitals, even though the folks who put together this information are not on the front lines of care. They're really busy doing things like keeping supply chains open and everything else. So again, appreciate all the help that we can get during this time.
Thank you for those comments, Devin. And if I could put you on the spot, not for an answer today, but if you could follow up with either a phone call or an email to me afterwards. During our monitoring of the conversations of the legislative bill on COVID-19, one legislator made the statement that hospitals could have a liquidity cash crisis within a short period of time. That is not what we've heard from any of the conversations that we've had from any of the hospitals. So maybe if Foz could just kind of try to define if they see any particular hospital with a liquidity crisis, if they could let us know.
We can certainly do that.
Thank you, Devin. Other members of the public for comment.
Hello, Kevin, this is Mark. I think on the liquidity crisis, what's going to be first is the liquidity that's going to trigger potentially a covenant violation. So while that may vary between the hospitals, at least from the health network perspective, I mean, we're not seeing any liquidity as far as making immediate payroll or anything like that. But there's certainly an eye on the mark. I mean, the stock market's down another 10% as we sit here right now. And you know, so I think what the liquidity measure is going to be as it relates to any covenant thresholds.
Certainly. That's going to be problematic as the statements come in and endowments and everything else are down 30 or more percent. It's going to be very trying on balance sheets. Any other member of the public that wishes to comment? If not, Council Barber, could you call the roll?
Sure. Member Holmes?
Yes.
Member Usifer?
Yes.
Member Lunge?
Yes.
Member Pelham?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. So let the record show it was a unanimous vote. And again, we're going to turn it back to you, Patrick. And I know you're going to walk through sustainability. At the end of the conversation, I would be hopeful that we could not try to move forward this in an expeditious manner, but rather continue to work on it at the staff level to come up with something that works for the hospitals and works for creating a truly good work product. But again, this is not something that I envision should be the number one priority for hospitals in the next 30 days. Patrick?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Before we get started, I do want to give a shout out to Abigail Conley, a member of staff, for guiding us through this entire meeting, working remotely and from multiple separate locations, and her ability to herd all of us cats is not unnoticed. So thank you, Abigail, for allowing this meeting to go so smoothly. So we're going to move into the sustainability plan piece of it. We've been asked to weigh in on some of the public comments as a way of recognizing and clarifying some of the points that were raised. After that, per Kevin's discussion just now, we'd like to hear a little bit more from the board on the direction that this goes. Of course, all of this so far has been done in a world that is kind of temporarily on hold right now. So it is a matter of process to move through this, and that's what we're going to do. Received three public comments from 2:26, the date of the original presentation, to 3:11 when comments closed. We bucketed the comments into a general topic such as the financial framework and then process, scope, and content. Some of the suggestions were that we use more Vermont-specific benchmarks, New England benchmarks, multi-year rolling averages, and trend analysis, and a component regarding the service line. So I'll start with that. We brought the presentation forward on the 26th regarding the S&P benchmark that we were using. Those were for 2018. They were released publicly in March of 2019. So just to clarify, they weren't behind the payroll. That was the result, or paywall. That was the result of a Google search. And to get as much information as possible, we put one of our email addresses into the S&P Global Rankings website, and unfortunately, they send a ton of information, but none of which we paid for. Should we decide to move forward in the future with the S&P benchmarks, we're definitely going to want to explore having to pay for them. So as of right now, it's not behind the paywall. It is accessible to anyone who has an email address, but in the future, it will be. If we want to keep updated information, we will have to pay for that. Regarding the financial metrics and discussion of operating metrics, we really wanted to adhere to the regulatory nature of our work by keeping ourselves adhering to financial metrics as a measure to follow the progress of the sustainability plans from that perspective and the impact they have on the hospital's sustainability and financial bottom line, balance sheet, income statement, et cetera. Because we regulate MPR growth and change in charges, we didn't want to go too far outside of that into the operational side of things. So therefore, the financial metrics moving forward, again, we're going to be a measure of progress and a recognition of the starting point for this change. And that's how we presented it. Did not want to involve ourselves in the operational metrics because those metrics are set and measured by hospital leadership. And we as staff would have a very hard time utilizing operational metrics hospital by hospital basis because they're very unique to each organization on a level that we would not have the resources to analyze. So that, again, is why we stuck with the financial metrics as a whole. Boards of directors hold their CEO accountable for operational goals and aims, and the CEO hands that responsibility and accountability down through the organization to achieve those. So we don't recommend utilizing any operating metrics in these plans moving forward. However, that could change, but as of right now, that's our recommendation. As presented, we believe the S&P metrics are appropriate. They're also an example. We do have flex monitoring, critical access hospital metrics that we've used for several years, and we would certainly be willing to incorporate those into any measurement for metrics regarding sustainability. The metrics from the S&P is being used to supplement the loft of metrics that in the past we were deriving from an Optum book that we received annually. We no longer have access to that. It seems they have suspended that publication, and we needed to fill that void. And S&P was the means by which we're seeking to do that. Any other analysis regarding rolling averages or trend analysis would be incorporated. We currently use that type of stuff in our regular hospital analysis on a monthly basis and with hospital budgets such as discussed today. So we wouldn't limit it just to the S&P. We would incorporate current practices as well. And that's a clarification on our end that we sought. We needed to bring to the public forum today. We do have confidence in those S&P figures. We do recognize as well that there's no perfect metric or set of metrics that will be useful to the specifics of every healthcare organization. During our CFO budget guide meetings, we did ask the subset of participating CFOs who they use to benchmark themselves against, and all stated they do use the S&P Global Rankings benchmarking. So we do have confidence that those are good figures to use and good benchmarking that we can use moving forward in sustainability and other applicable processes that we have. We are going to become more specific around those in the coming months. We are going to begin to ask our hospitals where they benchmark themselves. For example, the S&P does break it down into standalone hospitals, and you know, do they fall in the A-rated range, B-rated range, what have you, so that we know exactly where these hospitals are benchmarking themselves with the S&P. We also recognize that Vermont is under a separate regulatory framework, but that's not the only factor impacting our hospitals from a financial perspective, and we don't want to be short-sighted in limiting our benchmarking because of that lone item. Hospitals in Vermont are facing similar challenges and opportunities as hospitals around the nation, and we feel the S&P's information takes that into consideration. So we do recommend we continue that as at least one financial measuring tool, and we are open to adopting other ones as well. So that's our clarification and recognition around the financial and operational piece. The process scope and content bucket, we do recommend some more input from the stakeholders, hospitals specifically, or if we can more centrally work through Vaz and Jeff Thiemann and his team as far as building that framework out. Furthermore, we do recommend that sustainability as a term probably does need to be defined more so that those who are charged with delivering the plans have a clear understanding of that definition as preparation of those plans commence, whatever the time frame for that be moving forward. We also recommend that the goals be better defined overall, but also that each hospital should be allowed and expected to outline their unique and specific goals. There is no one-size-fits-all around this, and as we've stated, they're facing unique challenges, but they're also facing challenges together as well. And in the context of today's discussion, I think that's become more apparent than ever. We have spoken to the Vermont Office of Rural Health regarding the resource-intensive nature of this type of ask from our hospital. And we've spoken with John Olson. He's provided some feedback on potential funding that may be available to help consult on this topic, and we recommend making use of both of his resources and his extensive contacts nationwide regarding folks that he knows have worked on similar projects such as this. And finally, in time, the process should probably be expanded to all of the hospitals, but until we get a framework in place, understand the work involved, we would recommend that we stick to the original six hospitals. And once we establish that, then we recommend the board expand the order to the entire hospital system, as was recommended by one public comment. But we want to be conscious of the fact that we do this right on a smaller scale and then open it up from there, because it really is a system impact type of scenario that we're looking at now. So we did want to say that with the plan as presented, it is a step in the right direction. We are moving towards creating a sustainability framework. To Kevin's point, there is a little bit more that we do need to do on our end from a staff perspective, but we wanted to recognize the public comments and clarify where possible.
Okay, questions from the board.
Are they still there?
I'm still there. Here, it's Robin. I think, you know, Kevin, to your earlier comments, you know, the reason we started this in the first place is because we were concerned about ensuring the sustainability of our healthcare system, and it was an endeavor in a different environment. Given where we are now, I think doing some more work internally with staff and trying to figure out how to get additional stakeholder engagement when it's appropriate makes sense. But I agree with your opening comments. I quite frankly agree with what Jess said earlier, that sustainability planning is going to be even more essential after we move through and see the results of the emergency. But trying to figure out how to do that in a way that works with today's environment is what I feel like we need to focus on now.
Other comments from the board?
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I mean, I agree. And then as one of the board members who was pushing heavily to have these sustainability plans, you know, but I still agree that the timing has to be right in terms of the resources that the hospitals are going to need to devote to this. And I think if we can work internally among our staff to really tighten this up and think about what they should look like and look for external resources to help the hospitals. One of the public comments was about the time and the resource intensivity of this exercise. And so to the degree that we can find, ideally, some resources that already exist to put towards this, if we could find an external consultant that would be able to do this work consistently across the hospitals, that would be ideal. So I would look forward to kind of having those kinds of conversations about resource availability to reduce the burden on the hospitals, improve the consistency of the analysis. And I still do think this analysis is going to be even more important when we come out of this. But we have to respect what the hospitals are trying to do now with respect to public health crisis.
Other comments from the board? If not, does anyone from the public wish to comment on sustainability?
Hi, this is Eric Schulteis from the HCA. I agree with everything the board has said. Our office continues to have skepticism about the usefulness of the S&P indicators. You know, presumably we are going to be using these indicators moving forward in the future, as Patrick said. Future years are going to be behind a paywall. It's kind of irrelevant that the most recent data can be crazily found with difficulty. I think the issue of having Vermont hospitals as a group all being in the most vulnerable category probably isn't going to help develop policy interventions that are context sensitive, and you know, our comments stand regarding the other essential health services. I had emailed Elena some folks at UVM who have looked at transportation access to healthcare services, specifically in Vermont. They're based in UVM. They've published a few articles, appear to be transportation planners, so perhaps they would be a useful person to talk to about some of the aspects of sustainability planning that probably is going to be too much of a burden on the hospitals. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. Other members of the public?
This is Devin Green from the Vermont Association of Hospitals and Health Systems. And again, appreciate the board looking at the sustainability of our hospitals, and also appreciate that they recognize that at this time, hospitals really need to put all their efforts on COVID-19. And it's very unclear what things will look like afterwards. So as much internal process that can happen, that can also simplify the process and put off the process until we're out of COVID-19 would be helpful.
Thank you. Any other member of the public? Hearing none, question for General Counsel Barber. I don't believe we truly need a motion to have the staff keep trying to fine-tune and find funding sources or other resources that could help in this. But given the fact that it was part of budget orders, is there a motion that would have to be offered at this time or not?
I think we should take that back and talk about it. I mean, without changing the budget orders, I mean, what's coming to mind is the board could just not enforce that and kind of pursue this as the new direction. But I think we should probably think about that. And I don't see a need to decide that today. So.
Okay. So unless a board member finds a pressing need to make a motion, I think that we are done with sustainability discussion. At this point, is there any old business to come before the board? Hearing none, is there any new business to come before the board?
Yeah, I'm sorry. This is Howard from VPR. I'm wondering if you could just clarify that last sustainability conversation. I'm not quite sure what happened at the end there.
What happened at the end is that the staff is going to continue to work at fine-tuning what is a best practice for a sustainability plan that will actually yield good results for the hospitals and the future success of the hospitals. But at this point, we are not proceeding and expecting hospitals to do anything on sustainability in the short term, given the focus on dealing with COVID-19. And so we will continue to look for a funding source for outside resources to be of assistance when it is the proper time to go forward. But at this point in time, it is not the best use of hospitals' resources, given what they're facing today. Is there any new business to come before the board? So before I ask for a motion to adjourn, I just want to thank everyone. I didn't get much sleep last night worrying about how we were ever going to pull this off technologically and making sure that we committed to having public comment and abiding by the open meeting law. And so many people have worked behind the scenes to make this happen. And just truly amazed that we didn't have a technical glitch, because I thought for sure halfway through I was going to lose everyone and that I would be sitting here in a conference room wondering what to do. So I wish to thank everyone involved, especially Abigail and the finance team here, Janine and Jean, for really making sure that we had the technological capabilities to pull this off. So with that, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded, and unfortunately, I think we will have to do a roll call on that one as well. Mike Barber?
That's correct. Let's change the order up this time. Member Pelham?
Yes.
Member Yusufer?
Yes.
Member Lunge?
Yes.
Member Holmes?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. Have a great rest of the afternoon, everyone. Remember to keep safe and keep your social distances. And we look forward to a time where we're all back in the same room together.